Okay, given the element from the range space and the operator T, I want to find out X. This is called as inverse problem. Okay, and these are the problems which we normally have to solve. So the core of this particular course is dealing with these kind of problems, and the next class, which is identification problems. So here, what falls under this? So solving AX equal to B. So solving AX equal to B given A and B, classical problem, which given right hand side, given operator, you want to find out X, right? This is probably the problem which you will solve most often in this course. Then, so we are given some differential equation. So the other classical problem is ODE initial value problem. We are given a differential equation. So this is the operator. Okay, we are given FT. FT is equivalent to B, or FT is equivalent to the vector in the range space. Okay, I want to find out solution XT, which satisfies the condition that initial value is equal to alpha and initial rate is equal to beta. I am given two initial conditions. I am given the operator. I am given the vector in the range space. I want to find out solution XT. Okay, inverse problem. Operator is known. The range space vector is known. Okay, initial conditions are known. I want to find out XT. Inverse problem. So likewise, ODE boundary value problem is an inverse problem. Boundary value problem is an inverse problem, or solving a partial differential equation that that we encounter in engineering are mostly inverse problems. We are given the vector in the range space, we are given the operator, we have to find out X that satisfies the differential equation, boundary conditions, and solution gives you the vector in the range space. Okay, so these two problems are conceptually similar. AX equal to B, or this operator operating on XT giving you this vector FT. Okay, and then the solution should satisfy these two. So these kind of problems are inverse problems. So the third class of problems that you encounter in engineering mathematics are identification problems. So you are given X and Y, and you are asked to find out operator T. Okay? The classic problem here is model parameter estimation. Suppose I want for some particular material, you want to find out Cp as a function of temperature. So you have this A plus Bt plus C T square. I do not know A, B, C. I have been given values of Cp. I have been given values of temperature. Okay? So I have been given X. I have been given Y. Y here is Cp. Okay? X here is temperature. What I want to find out is the correlation, is the operator. Okay, I want to find out the operator. Finding operator, it in this case reduces to finding out A, B, and C. Okay, so given data, parameter estimation problem. What are the other parameter estimation problems you have seen in chemical engineering? Rate expressions, reaction rate expressions. You have measured the rate of change of a concentration of a particular species, and then you have a proposed expression. Okay, you don't know the parameters. Okay, you have rate values, you have concentration values, you want to find out the parameters of the rate expression, or you are trying to fit some thermodynamic correlation, PVT correlation. You have data for P, V and temperature, and you have a proposed model. You do not know the parameters. You can estimate the parameters from data. So you are trying to find out the operator, okay, knowing if you look at Y as an effect and X as a cause, okay, so the operator T operates on X, gives you Y. Y is the effect. So you know cause and effect. You want to find out the operator. Another example is estimation of transfer functions in process control. Okay, you give an input perturbation, you measure the output, you try to fit a transfer function into that data. Okay, all these are examples of identification problems. Okay, so bulk of our work in this course is going to be inverse problems, and then we'll also look at identification problems to a large extent. Direct problems are not going to be focused. I'm not saying the direct problems are not important, but they're relatively easy to deal with. These two problems are more difficult, and we should get a better understanding of these problems. Now, the main problem in most of the cases, not in every case, in most of the cases, is that once you have formulated a problem, it may not be possible to construct analytical solutions to the problem. Okay, particularly if the operator is nonlinear. Okay, so I can say in general, when operator T is nonlinear, you cannot construct analytical solutions. Well, there are of course many exceptions, but the cases where you cannot solve are far more than the cases where you can solve. So in general, you can say that when the operator T is nonlinear, so lot of numerical analysis is all about transforming a problem which is not analytically computable to a form which is numerically computable. Okay, so actually my original problem is y is equal to t of x. Okay, and where y belongs to space y and x belongs to space x. Okay, I am not able to solve this original problem. So what I do is I approximate T using approximation theory. And then I get let's call it T cap. Let's call this T cap. Okay, I get a T cap which actually works on X tilde and gives me Y tilde. Okay, here Y tilde belongs to YN and X tilde belongs to XN. So these are finite dimensional spaces typically. Typically, these are finite dimensional spaces, and then we end up solving this problem, not this problem. We hope that the solution that you get, suppose I solve an inverse problem, which is I wanted to solve the original inverse problem. I end up solving an approximate inverse problem, okay, and I hope that the solution x tilde is close to x. Okay, x tilde is close to x. So this is generally the situation. Now, how do you get from here to here? Next about 10 to 12 lectures are going to be, how do I go from here to here? So this looks abstract right now, but keep this in mind, in background, that this is what we are going to do. Okay. So we might start with a partial differential equation and end up with nonlinear algebraic equations. Okay. See, this might be a partial differential equation. What you end up here might be linear algebraic equations or nonlinear algebraic equations. Okay, so what you start with and what you end up with can be completely different. Okay, so it is not that because I start with a differential equation, I'll end up with a differential equation. Okay, now when you go from here to here, there is no unique way of constructing T cap. There are multiple ways of constructing T cap. Okay, same problem can be approximated, discretized in multiple possible ways. That's what we are going to see here. Okay, and each one of them has advantage and disadvantage. So there is nothing like the method to discretize. Okay, and as you go along doing numerical problems, you will develop your own preferences as to. So I'm going to talk about not just one method. I'm going to talk about multiple methods. So you might wonder, why am I talking about multiple methods? Because there is no one way to solve the problems. Sometimes some methods are simple, but if they don't work, you need to go to more complex methods and so on. Okay. So when you attack a problem, you should have a repository of tools or a repository of, you know, approaches to deal with a problem, and then you can go on, you know, simple method first. If it doesn't work, go to a more complex method. Doesn't work, go to a more complex method. What do you mean by doesn't work? The proof of the pudding is x tilde close to x? Does it make sense? Now you, in real situation, you never know what is x, true x. But since you are an engineer, okay, if you look at the solution, you can make out whether this makes physical sense or not. Okay, whether the solution makes sense, as an engineer, as a scientist, as a physicist, you can make a judgment and then decide whether your method is giving reasonable results or not. Okay, so there is a lot of subjective element here which requires development of expertise. Okay, so even though we are dealing with applied maths, which everything cannot be automated. Okay, and that's why we are in business. Okay, there is still scope for improvement, you know, for interpretations, for doing it differently, getting better solutions and so on. So now let's begin. Okay, so what is the trick? What is the basic trick that is? So if you ask me to distill out one basic idea which is used to do these transformations from T to T hat, okay, cutting across all the methods for boundary value problems, for partial differential equations, for all kinds of things, all kinds of, what is one trick that is used? Well, if you ask me to sum it up, I will say that approximate a function by polynomial. That is a trick, that is an underlying trick, you know, if I cut across many of the methods. And what I'm going to show in next few lectures is that how this one trick is used to, you know, deal with variety of problems. Okay, starting from nonlinear algebraic equations to partial differential equations to boundary value problems to all kinds of problems, all kinds of problems. We just use one trick in multiple ways. So basic idea is approximate now. The question is, well, is it just an observation? What is the basis? Why should I approximate a function by a polynomial function? Why not cosine functions? You know, why not exponential functions? Why polynomials? What is so great about them? Well, of course, they are convenient when you do calculations, but not just that. There's something deeper into why polynomials are used for approximating functions and then developing different methods for solving the problems. So a fundamental concept here is a concept of a dense set. See, approximations is something that we very, very often use in mathematics. For example, pi. You know, when you start using pi, you start using it as 22/7, right? But pi is not equal to 22/7. Right? It's an approximation of, it's a okay approximation of pi for doing, you know, rough calculations, not exact calculations. When you start using, for example, e. Okay, we never use the true value of e, right? We use an approximation, a finite truncated approximation of e and do calculations, right? So what allows you to do that? What allows you to do that is that you can approximate a real number using a rational number. Okay, You can approximate a real number using a rational number. This property of rational numbers is something special about rational numbers. We can approximate any real number as close as we want by a rational number. Okay, and this particular property is exploited by us when we do computations. And the best example I said is pi being replaced by 22 by 7 or whatever. There are different rational approximations of pi. You remember something else? Some 141 by or there are some other approximations also which are not so popular in the school books. But what we use in school book is 22 by 7, right? We are always. So why we can do this? Why? Or I told you that in when you are doing computing, okay, all the numbers are finite precision, right? No number in a computer. So there will be some missing numbers if there is a finite precision. Okay, not all numbers can be represented. Particularly, it's not possible to represent, you know, all real numbers. Pi may not be truly representable. You can represent using some truncation, because when you do finite precision, okay, if I write some expansion for pi, I can write that number divide. I can write an integer divided by some 10 to the power something, and that will be a rational number, right? So it is not. It is not the correct value for pi. It is a rational approximation for pi. Okay. So I am able to do this because of this denseness property. Okay. So what is a dense set? Okay, so let's go over the definition. A set D is said to be dense in a norm space. So first of all, we have to work in a norm space. We need norm. Okay, without that, we cannot work with numbers or vectors. So for any element, if I give you any element x in x, I should be able to find. And if I give you an epsilon. Okay, I should be able to find an element D belonging to dense set D, which is close to X. Okay, how close? Less than epsilon. So, you know, it's like saying if my X is pi, okay, and if I specify epsilon, you should be able to come up with a rational number which is close to pi such that the difference is less than epsilon. Now, you know, she might say that my epsilon is 10 to the power minus 3, okay, I will come up with one D which is one rational approximation of pi, pi minus D is less than 10 to the power minus 3, and he comes up and says, no, I don't accept 10 to the power minus 3, I want 10 to the power minus 9. Is it possible? It's possible to find, given pi, it's possible to find a rational approximation such that pi minus that number is less than 10 to the power minus 9. And somebody doesn't accept 10 to the power minus 9, and you know he says 10 to the power minus 17. Fine. I can find a rational number which is pi minus that rational number will be less than 10 to the power minus 17. So every epsilon, any epsilon, that is very important. Okay. So what does it mean that on real line these rational numbers are everywhere, you know? I can use them as approximation of something else, which I am not able to represent, which is very nice. Okay, it is very nice. So I can use rational number as an approximation of a real number, and that's why I can work in a computer. Okay, so when I am working in n-dimensional space, okay, in Rn, even though I may not be able to represent, all elements of the vector Rn, because a real number may not be exactly representable. I can replace it by its rational approximation. Okay, see, suppose I have a vector which is like this. Suppose I have a vector which is e minus pi, pi square root 7. In a computer, can I really work with e minus pi? I cannot. Right? I actually replace this by some approximations. So, some rational approximation of e, some rational approximation of this, some rational approximation of this, and so on. And why we can do this? Because set of, understand the philosophy. Why we can do this is because set of rational numbers is dense. Okay, rational numbers are everywhere. You can just, if you want to represent a real number, pick a very close rational number. You know, you will be having a good approximation. Okay, now, I want a similar result to this in a set of continuous functions. Okay, what I am going to work with, now we have seen that, you know, when you deal with partial differential equations, when you deal with boundary value problems, when you deal with ordinary differential equations, you will be dealing with set of continuous functions. Okay, so this is nice here that, you know, I can use rational approximations, some q1, q2, q3, q4. So this is a rational approximation of this, and in my computer I can do calculations with this. The same way, I want analogy instead of continuous functions. This is a similar idea, conceptually similar idea, is that set of polynomials is dense instead of continuous functions. Okay, set of polynomials is dense in the set of continuous functions. In the same sense, the set of rational numbers is dense in set of real numbers. Okay, polynomials, you know, you can approximate anything by a polynomial, any continuous function by a polynomial. So this was a landmark theorem given by a German mathematician, Weierstrass, I think somewhere in 1850s or 1860s. And this is a celebrated theorem by, called as So this is a well-known result. Well, this particular result is what is called as an existence result. Okay, I'll tell you what I mean by existence result. It doesn't tell you how to construct a polynomial approximation. It assures that given a continuous function, there exists a polynomial which is arbitrarily close to the continuous function. Now, what is arbitrary closeness? You need norm. Okay. What is arbitrary closeness? You need concept of norm. So, now what do we consider here? We consider the set of continuous functions over an interval AB together with infinite norm. Okay? Together with infinite norm. So, this is the space, this is the norm defined on it, this is a norm linear space. Okay? Now, Weierstrass theorem tells us that, well, I'll move on to here to complete this theorem statement. So if I give you any epsilon greater than 0, any degree of accuracy, epsilon will specify how accurate you want the approximation, okay? And if I pick up any continuous function ft from CAB, set of continuous functions over AB, then there exists a polynomial very, very important result. Okay. So what does it say? Given any epsilon, you give me the accuracy that you want, how close an approximation you want. Okay. You can specify that epsilon and give me any function ft which is a continuous function. Okay. Then there exists a polynomial approximation. I am going to call this as pnt. N will be, let's say, order of the polynomial. Okay. Such that ft minus pnt is less than epsilon. Okay, is less than epsilon. Is this clear? So what is this norm? This norm is absolute norm. We are finding out difference between maximum of the absolute value. See, if I give you a function, let's say sin t. Okay, this theorem tells me there is an nth order polynomial such that sin t minus the polynomial absolute of this, okay, maximum over the interval will not exceed epsilon. You specify epsilon, I will construct a pn. Okay, you give me an epsilon, I can. Now how do you construct a pn is not what is told by this theorem. It just says that there exists. Okay, how do you construct that approximation? Well, that is a different story. It only assures that there exists a polynomial which is arbitrarily close. How do you find out that particular polynomial is not given by this theorem, but it tells you that there exists a polynomial. So which means when I'm approximating a transformation, I could use this basic idea to transform a differential equation or transform boundary value problem or a partial differential equation into some simplified form. We'll do it much more in detail, but I'll just give you a very, very simple example. Okay. So do you see parallels between here and here? We are talking about finding out a rational number which is arbitrarily close to a real number, and using that rational number for calculations instead of the real number. Okay. Same idea we are going to do here. Okay, the true solution would be a continuous function. Okay, I am going to approximate that continuous function by a polynomial function. Why? That will help me to solve the problem. It will help me to solve the problem, and by transforming the operator, by solve the problem in a different way, which is easier than the original problem. Well, one simple. This kind of things will hit on later. Let's look at a very, very simple demonstration. See, if I have dx by dt is equal to some f of x. Okay, and I have given you initial condition corresponds to say x naught. Okay, now. What is xt? Let's say x star t is the true solution. X star t is a true solution. Okay, is this a continuous function? It has to be a continuous function. It has to be, in fact, differentiable function, not just continuous. It has to be a differentiable function. So it's a continuous function. Any continuous function can be approximated by a polynomial function. I propose a polynomial solution, which is say pnt, or I will call it xt, which is a naught plus a1t plus a2t square. Let me propose a polynomial solution. Now, this is a polynomial approximation. This is not a true solution, but I can substitute it here. I can substitute it here, and I can say that, well, I want the approximate solution such that. So what is dx by dt? A1 plus 2 a to t. Right? And then I can substitute this here. So for any t, I want this equation to hold, that is a1 plus 2 a to t is equal to f of a0 plus a1 t plus a2 t square. Right? I am doing something which is very naive. We will do it much more sophisticated manner afterwards. I just want to carry some point here. Look, this is a differential equation I started with. I approximated using a polynomial form with unknown coefficients. I do not know a0, a1, a2. True solution is x star. With what boldness I can do this? I know that a continuous function can be approximated by a polynomial function. Okay, I substituted this. What happened? What looked like originally a differential equation now looks like an algebraic equation with unknowns a1, a2, a0. The problem is transformed from a differential equation to an algebraic equation. Okay, so this idea of using a polynomial approximation of a continuous function will be used to transform problems which are originally, so original operator t was a differential operator, t prime or t cap, what you are getting here looks like an algebraic. So I was talking about, you know, starting with an original problem, transforming the problem and solving the transform problem. So we might actually, computationally, this is easier to track than this. We might solve this as compared to this. What we get by this approach is the approximate solution, not the true solution. Remember that. Okay? It's an approximate solution. But then if you can accept 22 by 7 in place of pi, you can accept these approximate solution, and as long as it is close and you know your physics is preserved in some sense qualitatively, you don't bother too much about the difference between the two. Okay, so this is how it's going to help us in transforming the problems. So what is used? So Weierstrass approximation theorem as such, we never revisit again, but it is the foundation everywhere. You know, Weierstrass theorem comes at in a hidden form. It is everywhere because we approximate continuous solutions using polynomials. So somebody asked, what is the basis? Why polynomials? Because polynomials are dense. Why should I be so much worried about a dense set? You know, dense set is something which pick an element from a dense set, and it can be as close as possible to the original, element in the original set. Okay, so dense set is a special set. So just like set of rational numbers is a special set in real numbers, polynomials, set of polynomials is a special dense set in set of continuous functions. Okay, so this is the foundation. This is a cornerstone result. But this doesn't tell you how to construct a polynomial approximation. Now, we are going to use three different tricks for constructing polynomial approximations. One is so there are three different ways by which we are going to construct the polynomial approximations. First is the Taylor series approximation. You are familiar with Taylor series expansions. We'll just revisit them briefly in the next lecture. Then we move on to polynomial interpolation polynomials. Okay, and the third is the least squares approximation. Okay, so if you understand these three basic concepts, most of the problem transformations will be clear to you, how the problem is transformed to a computable form. Okay, then comes how to solve the transform problem. Okay, so that is the next part. So till mid-sem, we'll be actually working on now this. We'll systematically look at different problems, particularly boundary value problems, partial differential equations, nonlinear algebraic equations, and all kinds of things where we use these ideas, these three ideas, and then transform the problem to a computable form. So next 12 lectures are about problem formulation. Okay, you have formulated the problem from physics, and you got some problem which is coming from your courses in transport, reaction engineering, whatever, heat transfer, strength of materials, whatever your specialization. So those original problem is coming from there. Okay, I want to compute a solution for this, a numerical solution for this problem. So I use all these tricks to transform the problem to a computable form, and then I solve that computable form. Okay, construct a solution which is approximate numerical solution to the problem. Okay, so in the next class, we will start with Taylor series approximations. Okay, I'll very quickly review Taylor series approximation. What is the basis behind Taylor series approximation? You are aware of only one variable Taylor series. We'll move on to multivariable Taylor series. Okay, polynomial functions in n variables. Okay, and then we'll look at, for example, one of the application of this Taylor series would be Newton-Raphson method. Okay, then we'll move on to show that this Taylor series approximation actually gives rise to the finite difference method of solving boundary value problems, finite difference method of solving partial differential equations, okay, and so on, or the polynomial interpolations. So we'll develop in the class method of orthogonal collocations and see how orthogonal collocations arises from polynomial interpolations, and so on. So all these three different approaches give rise to different ways of problem discretization, and that will be the center theme for next few lectures.